grow up, and the way Wendy knew was this. One day, when she was 2 years old, she was playing in a garden. She plucked a flower and ran with it to her mother. I suppose she must have looked rather delightful, for Mrs. Darling put her hand to her heart.
Oh, why can't you remain like this forever?
This was all that passed between them on the subject, but henceforth, Wendy knew she must grow up. You always know after you are two. Two is the beginning of the end. Wendy was the first child, then John, then Michael. The Darling family was complete. Mrs. Darling loved to have everything just so, and Mr. Darling had a passion for being exactly like his neighbors. So of course, they had a nurse. This nurse is a prim Newfoundland dog called Nana. She proved to be quite a treasure of a nurse. There never was a simpler, happier family until the coming of Peter Pan. Wendy often explained in quite a matter-of-fact way that she thought Peter came to the nursery in the night and sat on the foot of her bed and played on his pipes to her. Unfortunately, she never woke, so she didn't know how she knew. She just knew. Mrs. Darling did not know what to think of all this, for it was all so natural to Wendy that you could not dismiss it by saying she had been dreaming. But she had not been dreaming, as the very next night showed. The night on which the adventures of these children may be said to have begun. The children were once more in bed. It happened to be Friday, which was Nana's evening off. Mrs. Darling had bathed them and sung to them, till one by one they let go her hand and slid away into the land of sleep. Then suddenly, the nursery window blew open and a boy dropped into the floor. Mrs. Darling screamed and sprang at the boy, who leapt lightly back through the window. Mrs. Darling was terrified, for she thought he fell and was killed. But when she looked out to find his little body, it was not there. And when she looked up, she could see nothing but what she thought was a shooting star. On the floor, she found a rather odd object, which proved to be the boy's shadow. As he leapt at the window, she had closed it quickly, too late to catch him, but his shadow had not had time to get out. Slam went the window and snapped the shadow off. Mrs. Darling examined the shadow carefully, but it was quite the ordinary kind. She decided to roll it up and put it away carefully in a drawer until a fitting opportunity came for telling her husband. That opportunity came a week later on that never-to-be-forgotten Friday.
I won't go to bed. I won't. I won't. It isn't 6 o'clock yet. I tell you, I won't be bathed. I won't. I won't.
A little less noise there.
You sound just like Father.
I am happy to inform you, Mrs. Darling, that you are now a mother.
Oh, happy day. She shall be named Wendy.
I'm even happier to inform you, Mrs. Darling, that you now have a son as well.
And he will be named John. May I be born as well?
No, we don't want any more.
Nobody wants tea.
I so want a third child.
Mother, I'm glad of you.
Mother! Mother!
Don't you play things like that, for goodness sake.
What is the matter, dear?
Matter? Well, this tie. It will not tie. Not round my neck. Round the bedpost, yes. Oh, 20 times have I made it up round the bedpost, but round my neck, no. Dear no, I warn you of this, Mother, that unless this tie is round my neck, we don't go out to dinner tonight. And if we don't go out to dinner tonight, then I never show my face at the office again. And if I don't go to the office again, you and I starve, and our children shall be flung into the streets.
Let me try here. I have been wanting to talk to you about something peculiar. I believe that our children have been receiving an uninvited visitor while they sleep.
Nonsense. No one can get into the house without us knowing.
I believe he comes in through the window.
My love, it is 3 floors up.
I know, George, but last week I saw a strange boy spring through the window. I closed it quickly, too late to catch him, but his shadow had no time to get out. When the window slammed shut, off came the shadow.
Hmm. Well, let's have a look then.
Thank you.
believe it's anyone we know. Though he does look a scoundrel.
Oh, I don't want any medicine.
Come now, Michael, be a man.
Oh, I won't, I won't.
Here, my dear, let me fetch him a chop.
Mother, don't pamper him. Michael, when I was your age, I took medicines without a murmur. I said, thank you, kind parents, for giving me bottles to make me well.
That medicine you sometimes take, Father, is much nastier, isn't it? Oh,
ever so much nastier. And I would take it now as an example to you, Michael, if I hadn't lost the bottle.
I know where it is, Father. I'll take it.
It really is most beastly stuff. It's that dreadful, sticky, sweet kind.
It will soon be over, Father.
I've been as quick as I could.
You have been wonderfully quick. Michael first.
Oh, Father first!
I shall be sick, you know.
Oh, come on, Father.
Hold your tongue, John.
I thought you took it quite easily, Father.
That is not the point. The point is that there is more in my glass than there is in Michael's spoon. It isn't fair. I would say it as though it were my last breath. It isn't fair.
Father, I am waiting.
Well, it is all very well to say that you are waiting, so am I waiting.
Father's a cowardly custard.
So are you a cowardly custard.
Well, I'm not frightened.
Well, neither am I frightened.
Well, then take it.
Well, then. You take it.
Why not both take it at the same time?
Certainly. Are you ready, Michael?
One, two, three.
By old father. I meant to take mine, but I missed.
I've told you. He sometimes comes into the nursery at night and sits at the foot of my bed and plays his pipes.
Whatever do you mean, Wendy?
It is always so naughty of him not to wipe his feet.
What nonsense you talk.
It's true. He's rather cocky.
Wendy, I cannot abide with you carrying on with these absurd stories.
But Father...
Peter Pan, poppycock.
Father,
absolute
no...
Absolute poppycock. My darling, Wendy has grown up. It is high time she had a room of her own.
No!
What? No more of these ridiculous stories.
Father!
My mind is made up. Young lady, this is your last night in the nursery, and that is my final word on the matter.
Mother, how could he?
Oh, please do not mind your father. He was just upset and wants to do what's best for you. Your father and I do love you very much. Now, to bed with you.
Thank you.
a short distance away. They were already the only persons in the street, and all the stars were watching them. Stars are beautiful, but they may not take an active part in anything. They must just look on forever. As soon as the darlings were gone and the door was closed, the smallest of all the stars in the Milky Way screamed out, "Now, Peter!"
Out of that jug and tell me. Do you know where they put my shadow? In the big box. What's your name?
Wendy Moira Angela Darling. What's your name?
Peter Pan.
Is that all?
Yes.
I'm so sorry.
Doesn't matter.
Where do you live?
Second star to the right and then straight on till morning.
What a funny address.
Oh, no, it isn't.
I mean, is that what they put on your letters?
Well, don't get any letters.
But your mother gets letters.
You don't have a mother.
Oh, Peter. No wonder you were crying.
I wasn't crying about mothers. I was crying because I can't get my shadow to stay. Besides, I wasn't crying.
It has come off?
Yes.
How awful.
Why shouldn't it?
How exactly like a boy? It must be sewn on.
Well, what's sewn?
You're dreadfully ignorant.
I am not.
I shall sew it on for you, my little man. I dare say, it will hurt a little.
Oh, I shan't cry.
Thank you. it a little.
A little. Well, if I'm no use, I can at least withdraw.
Wendy, don't withdraw. I can't help crowing when I'm pleased with myself. Wendy, one girl is more use than 20 boys.
Do you really think so, Peter?
Yes, I do.
I think it's perfectly sweet of you. I shall give you a kiss if you like. Surely you know what a kiss is.
I shall know when you give it to me. Well, now shall I give you a kiss?
If you please. I shall wear your kiss on a chain around my neck. How old are you?
I don't know, but I am quite young. Wendy, I ran away the day I was born. I overheard father and mother talking about what I was to be when I became a man. But I don't want ever to be a man. I want always to be a little boy and have fun. So I ran away. And I lived a long, long time among the fairies.
Oh, Peter, tell me of the fairies.
They're nearly all dead now. You see, when the first baby laughed for the first time, its laugh broke into 1,000 pieces. And they all began skipping about. And that was the beginning of fairies. So there ought to be a fairy for every boy and girl.
Ought to be? Isn't there?
No. You see, children know such a lot now, they soon don't believe in fairies. And every time a child says, I don't believe in fairies, there's a fairy somewhere that falls dead. Dead. You can't think where Tink has gone to. Tink!
Peter, you don't need to tell me that there's a fairy in this room.
You don't hear her, do you?
All I hear is like a sound of a tinkle of bells.
Well, that's Tink. That's the fairy language. I think I hear her too. Wendy, I do believe I shut her in the drawer. Oh. Well, you shouldn't say such things, Tink. Of course, I'm awfully sorry, but how was I to know that you were in the drawer?
Oh, Peter, if only she would stand still and let me see her.
I hardly ever stand still. Tink, this lady says she wishes you were her favorite.
What did she say, Peter?
Well, she's not very polite. She says that you're a big, ugly girl, and that she's my favorite. You know you can't be my favorite, Tink, because I'm a gentleman and you're a lady. Tinkerbell because she mends the pots and kettles.
Where do you live mostly now?
With the Lost Boys.
Who are they?
They are the children who fall out of their carriages when the nurse is looking the other way. If they're not claimed in 7 days, they're sent far away to the Neverlands to defray expenses. I'm Captain.
What fun it must be.
Yes. But we are rather lonely. You see, we have no female companionship.
Are there no other girls?
Oh, no. Girls, you know, are far too clever to fall out of their carriages.
I think it's perfectly lovely the way you talk about girls. John there just despises us. Since you've been so kind, you may give me a kiss.
I thought you would want it back.
Oh, dear, I don't mean a kiss. I mean a thimble.
Well, what's that?
It's like this.
Funny. Well, now shall I give you a thimble?
If you wish to.
That must have been Pink. I never knew her to be so naughty before. She says she will do that to you, Wendy, every time I give you a thimble.
Well, what, Tink? Get out.
Peter, why do you come to my nursery window?
To listen to stories.
I see.
Well, I don't know any stories. And I'm in the Lost Boys knowing stories.
How awful.
Oh, Wendy, your mother was telling you such a lovely story.
Which story was it?
About the prince who couldn't find the lady who wore the glass slipper.
Peter, that was Cinderella, and he found her. And they lived happily ever after.
Where are you going?
To tell the other boys.
Oh, don't go, Peter. I know such lots of stories. Oh, the stories I could tell to the boys. Oh, the stories I could tell to you and the boys. Oh, let me go!
Wendy, do come with me and tell the other boys.
Oh, dear, I can't. Think of Mummy. Besides, I can't fly.
I'll teach you.
Oh, don't love me.
I'll teach you how to jump up on the wind's back, and then away you go. Wendy, when you are sleeping in your silly bed, you might be flying about with me, saying funny things to the stars. And Wendy, there are mermaids.
Mermaids with tails?
Such long tails!
Oh, to see a mermaid!
Wendy, how we should all respect you. You could tuck us in at night. Well, none of us have ever been tucked in at night.
Oh.
You could darn our clothes and make pockets for us. Well, none of us have any pockets.
Of course, it's frightfully fascinating. Peter, do you think you could teach John and Michael to fly too?
If you like.
Wake up! Peter Pan has come and he is to teach us to fly!
Oh, Emma!
Me too!
Sorry, I say, Peter, can you really fly?
Wow!
How topping!
How sweet!
Yes, I'm sweet, oh, I am sweet.
I say, how do you do it?
You just think lovely, wonderful thoughts, and then they lift you into the air.
I've got it now. Wendy!
Oh, I forgot. You must also have the magic fairy dust blown on you. Now you're ready.
I said, what are we all going?
How long will it take for me to do a billion miles?
Surely it is safer here at home.
Mermaids, Wendy. And there are pirates!
Pirates, let us go at once!
There's not a moment to lose! Come away!
It was just at this moment that Mr. and Mrs. Darling were returning home. They looked up at the nursery window and saw a most ghastly sight. Not three figures, but four. Will they reach the nursery in time? If so, how delightful for them. We should all breathe a sigh of relief. But then there would be no storm. Mr. and Mrs. Darling rushed into the nursery too late. The birds were flown.
Thank you.
corners. Could not have sighted it with these instructions. Peter, you see, just said anything that came into his head. Sometimes it was light, sometimes dark. Sometimes it was very cold, and sometimes too warm. Certainly, they did not pretend to be sleepy, but they were asleep, which was a danger, for the moment they fell asleep, down they fell. The awful thing was, Peter thought this was funny. Sometimes Peter was not with them, and they felt rather lonely up there by themselves. He could go up so much faster than they, but would suddenly shoot out of sight to have some adventure in which they had no share. He would come down, laughing over something fearfully funny he'd been saying to the star. But he'd already forgotten what it was. Or he would come up with mermaid scales still sticking to them, and yet not be able to say for certain what had been happening.
Where is Peter? What could we do if he were to leave us?
Well, we could go back.
How could we ever find our way without him?
Well, we could go on.
That's the awful thing, John. We would have to go on, for we don't know how to stop.
Well, if worst came to worst, all we would have to do is just go straight on. For the world is round, you see. And so in time, we must come back to our own window.
Here he comes. Good day.
Hello, Peter.
Hello, too. Who might you be?
I'm Wendy.
Ah, yes. I say, if you see me, forget me. Just keep on saying, I'm Wendy, and then I'll remember.
That's rather unsatisfactory.
There it is.
There what is?
The Neverland.
Where
all the sun's arrows are pointed.
It's just as I always imagined. Oh, John, there's the lagoon.
Look, Michael, there's a cave.
John, I think I see the smoke of an Indian camp.
Where? Show me where it is, and I can tell you by which way the smoke curls whether or not they're on the warpath.
There, just across the mysterious river.
Oh, I see it now. Yes, they are on the warpath right enough.
Would you like an adventure now, or would you like to have your tea first?
Tea first.
What kind of adventure?
I see a pirate asleep in the crow's nest just beneath us. If you like, we'll go down and kill him.
I don't see him.
I do.
Suppose he were to wake up.
You don't think I'd kill him while he was sleeping.
I'd wake him up first and then kill him. That's the way I always do it.
I say, do you kill many?
Tons.
How rude.
Are there many pirates on the island just now?
I've never known so many.
Who's captain then?
Hook.
James Hook?
Aye.
He was Blackbeard's bosun. He's the worst of them all. He's the only man of whom Long John Silver was afraid.
That's him.
What's he like? Is he big?
He's not so big as he was.
How do you mean?
I cut off a bit of him.
You?
Yes, me.
I wasn't meaning to be disrespectful.
Well, all right.
But I say, what bit?
His right hand.
Then he can't fight that.
Oh, can't he just?
Left hand.
He has an iron claw instead of a right hand, and he claws me.
Claws.
I say, John.
Yes?
Say aye, sir.
Aye, aye, sir.
There's one thing every boy who serves under me has to promise, and it is this. If we meet Hook in open battle, you must leave him to me.
I promise.
Look, the pirates have spotted us! And got long time!
The big gun?
Oh, if only something would make a sound! As if in answer to Michael's request, the air was rent with the most tremendous crash he had ever heard. The pirates had fired Long Tom at them. The roar of it echoed through the mountains, and the echoes seemed to cry savagely, "Where are they? Where are they? Where are they?" Thus sharply did the terrified three learn the difference between an island of make-believe and the same island come true.
Are you shot, Michael?
Oh, I haven't tried to breathe yet. Where's Wendy?
The blast from Long Tom must have scattered her and Peter away.
Oh, what shall we do?
I suppose we must make our way to the Neverland ourselves.
We know now that no one had been hit. Peter, however, had been carried by the wind of the shot far up to sea, while Wendy was blown upwards with no companion but Tinkerbell. I don't know whether Tinkerbell planned it on the way or if the idea came suddenly to her, but sensing opportunity, she led Wendy to her destruction.
Now
sometimes Tink was not all bad. She was sometimes all good. Fairies are so small, they unfortunately have room for only one feeling at a time. At present, Tink was full of jealousy for Wendy. And so she led Wendy to her doom. Feeling that Peter was on his way back, the Neverland once again woke into life. On this particular evening, the Lost Boys were out looking for Peter, while the Pirates were out looking for the Lost Boys, the Redskins were out looking for the Pirates, and the Beasts were out looking for the Redskins. All were going round and round the island, but they did not meet, for all were going at exactly the same rate. All wanted blood, except the boys, who liked it as a rule, but tonight they were out to greet their captive.
I wish Peter would come back.
Me too.
I wish he would come back and tell us whether he has heard anything more about Cinderella.
I am confident that my mother must have been very like her.
Toodle! Peter has strictly forbidden any talk on the subject of mothers.
But where is Peter?
Yo-ho, yo-ho, the pirates like the flag of skull and bones. A merry hour, a hemp and rope, and hey, for Davy Jones. Yeah!
Captain, let go.
Put back that pistol first.
It was one of those boys you hate. He's gonna shoot him dead.
Aye, and the sound would have brought Tiger Lily's warriors upon us. Do you want to lose your scalp?
Shall I after him, Captain?
No, Smee. He's only one, and I want to fall all of them. Scatter and look for them. Most of all, I want Peter Pan.
Was he cut off my arm? I've waited long to shake his hand with this.
I'll tell him!
And yet, I have often heard you say that hook was worth a score of hands for combing the hair and other homely uses.
If I were a mother, I would pray that my children be born with this instead of that. But Peter threw my hand to a crocodile that happened to be passing by.
I have often noticed your strange dread of crocodiles.
Not of crocodiles, but of that one crocodile. Cursed beast likes the taste of me so much that he's followed me ever since, from sea to sea and from land to land, licking his chops for the rest of me.
In a way, it's sort of a compliment.
I want no such compliments. I want Peter Pan, who first gave the brute his taste for me. Smee, that croc would have happened long ere this, but by some lucky chance, he swallowed a clock which goes tick, tick, tick inside him. And so, before he can reach me, I hear the tick and bolt.
Someday, the clock will run out, and then it'll get you.
Aye, it's the fear that haunts me.
Did you hear them say Peter Pan's away from home? Unwrap your plan, Captain!
We shall return to the ship and cook a large, rich cake of a jolly thickness with green sugar on it, all iced over with poison. We shall leave it by the shore of the Mermaid's Lagoon. Those boys are always playing about there, swimming with the mermaids. And they shall gobble it up, for, having no mother, they do not know how dangerous it is to eat damp, rich cake. They will die.
It's the wickedest, prettiest policy ever I heard of.
Just as you say. And let us return to the ship and set about it at once. Smee.
Crocodile Smee, what are you doing? Protect me,
Smee! Can't
Tinkerbell. I'm your friend no more. Be gone from me forever. Okay, not forever, but for a whole week.
Let us carry her down into the house.
Aye, that is what one does with ladies.
No, no, you mustn't touch her. It would not be sufficiently respectful.
That is what I was thinking.
But if she lies here, she will die.
Aye, she will die. There is no way out.
Yes, there is. Let us build a little house around her.
What a house!
Hello, Peter.
Hello.
My name is John.
doctor?
Yes, my little man.
Please, sir, a lady lies very...
Tut, tut, tut. Where does she lie?
In yonder glade.
I will put this glass thing in her mouth.
Ooh. How is she?
Tut, tut, tut. It has cured her.
I am glad.
Give her beef tea out of a cup with a spark to it. She'll call again in the evening.
Where am I?
Wendy lady, for you we have long waited, and we are your children.
Oh, Wendy lady, be our mother.
Ought I? Of course. It's frightfully fascinating. But you see, I'm only a little girl. I have no real experience.
That doesn't matter. What we need is just a nice motherly person.
Oh dear. You see, I feel that's exactly what I am.
It is this!
We saw it at once!
Well then, I will do my best. Come inside at once, you naughty children. I'm sure your feet are damp. And just before I put you to bed, I have time to tell you the story of Cinderella.
And they went. I don't know how there was room for everyone, but you can squeeze very tight in the Neverland. This was just the first of many joyous evenings they had. Meanwhile, Peter kept watch outside with drawn sword, for the pirates could be heard carousing far away, and the wolves were on the prowl.
Captains have always put sailors on it and left them here to drown. You see, Wendy, when the tide rises, the rocks become completely submerged.
But Peter, you don't think that...
Pirates! Pirates!
The boat drew nearer. It was the pirate with three figures in her. Smee, Starkey, and the third a captive, no other than Tiger Lily. Her hands and ankles were tied, she knew she was to be left on the rocks to perish. Yet her face was impassive. She was the daughter of the chief. She must die the chief's daughter. They had caught her boarding the pirate ship with a knife in her mouth. No watch was kept on the ship, it being Hook's boast that the wind of his name could guard the ship for a mile around. Now her fate would help to guard it also.
Luff, you lover! Here's the rock. Now then, what we have to do is to place the girl onto it and leave her there to drown.
Pity thee, beauty. There is no path through water to the happy hunting ground.
Ahoy there, you lover.
The captain!
He must be swimming out to us.
We are putting the captive on the rock!
Set her free.
Free?
Yes, put her bonds and let her go.
But Captain, we caught her boarding a ship with a knife in her mouth.
At once, do you hear? I'll plunge my hook in you.
Oh, this is queer.
Better do what the captain orders.
Aye, aye.
Boat ahoy! Boat ahoy!
It is a princely scheme. The boys, we shall kidnap and carry them to the boat. We shall make them walk the plank and the Wendy shall be our mother.
Never!
What was that?
Must have been away from the wind.
Do you agree, me bullies?
Oh, there's my hand on it.
And mine. And there is my book. Swear.
We swear!
Where is the Indian?
Oh, that is all right, Captain. We let her go.
You let her go.
'Twas your own orders.
You called out over the water for us to let her go.
Brimstone and gall, what cozening is this?
But Captain...
Lads, I gave no such order.
Oh, this is passing queer.
Spirit that haunts this dark lagoon tonight, dost hear me? Who are you, stranger? Speak.
I am James Hook, captain of the Jolly Run.
Oh, no, you're not! Well, if you are Hook, then come, tell me, who am I?
A codfish.
A codfish.
Have we been captained all this time? By a codfish?
It is lowering to our pride!
Shut up! Tell me, Hook, have you another voice?
I have.
And another name?
I.
Vegetable?
No.
Mineral?
No.
Animal?
Yes.
Man?
No!
Boy?
Yes.
Ordinary boy?
No.
Wonderful boy?
Yes.
You asked some questions.
No!
It comes for Hook and gets the boy in green.
Help! Help!
We must go.
Yes.
Shall we swim or fly, Peter?
Do you think you could swim or fly as far as the island, Wendy, without my help?
I'm too tired, Peter. What is it?
I can't help you, Wendy. Hook has wounded me. I can neither fly nor swim.
Do you mean we shall both be drowned?
The water will soon be rising.
Help! Help! I will stay here with you.
And you, a lady?
No.
Goodbye, Wendy.
Peter! No!
Unforgettable night when Peter almost perished at the hook. One important result of the brush with the pirates on the lagoon was it made the Redskins their friends. Peter had saved Tiger Lily from a dreadful fate, and now there was nothing she or her braves would not do for him. All night they sat above, keeping watch over the home under the ground and awaiting the big attack by the pirates, which obviously could not be delayed much longer. That day, as if quietly gathering its forces, had been almost uneventful. And now, the Redskins and their blankets were at the post above, while below, the children were having their evening meal. All except Peter, who had gone out to get the time. The way you got the time on the island was to find the crocodile and stay near him till the clock struck. We have now reached the evening that was to be known among them as the Night of Nights.
Is your mug empty slightly, darling?
Not quite empty, Mummy.
He hasn't even begun to drink his milk.
I complain of nibs.
Well, John?
May I sit in Peter's chair as he's not here?
Sit in Father's chair, John? Certainly not.
He's not really our father. He didn't even know what a father did until I told him.
We complain of John.
I don't suppose that I could be father.
No, Toodles.
Well, do you think I could be a twin?
No, indeed. It's awfully difficult to be a twin.
As I can't be anything important, would any of you like to see me do a trick?
No! Slightly coughing on the table!
The twins began with cheesecakes!
Curly's taking both butter and honey!
Nibs is speaking with his mouth full!
I complain of the twins!
I complain of Curly!
I complain of my wife!
Oh, dear. I'm sure I sometimes think spinsters are to be envied. Children, I hear your father's step. He likes you to greet him at the door.
Hello, boys!
Peter! Oh, Peter, you're just spoiled, then, you know.
Ah, old lady.
It was me that told him to call her old lady.
I complain of Michael.
Father, we want to dance.
Well, dance away, my little man.
But we want you to dance.
And Mommy, too.
Me? Well, my old bones would rattle.
Not until you put on your nighties.
Ah, old lady. There is nothing more pleasant of an evening for you and me when the day's toil is over than to rest by the fire with the little ones nearby.
It is sweet, isn't it? Peter, I think Curly has your nose.
Well, Michael takes after you.
Dear Peter, with such a large family, of course, I have now passed my best, but you don't want to change me, do you?
No, Wendy.
Peter,
just thinking.
It is only make-believe, isn't it? That I'm their father?
Oh. Yes.
You see, it would make me seem so old to be their real father.
But they are ours, Peter. Yours and mine.
But not really, Wendy.
Not if you don't wish it. Peter.
What are your exact feelings for me?
Those of a devoted son, Wendy.
I thought so. You are so queer, and Tiger Lily is just the same. There are some things she wants to be to me, but she says it is not my mother.
No, indeed, it is not.
Well, then what is it?
It isn't for a lady to tell.
Oh, all right. Perhaps Tinkerbell will tell me.
Oh, yes, Tinkerbell will tell you. She isn't a bandit, little creature. Time for bed, my children.
End of story? Yes, Mother?
Why, yes. Of course. Listen, then. There once was a gentleman.
I'd rather it'd been a lady.
I wish he'd been a white rat.
Quackets. There is a lady also. And
oh, Mommy, you do mean there is a lady also, don't you? She is not dead, is she?
Oh, no.
I'm awfully glad she isn't dead. Are you glad, John?
Of course I am.
Are you glad, Nibs?
Rather.
Are you glad, Prince?
We are glad.
Little less noise there. Now, the gentleman's name was Mr. Darling, and her name was Mrs. Darling.
I knew them.
I think I knew them.
They were married, you know, and what do you think they had?
White rats!
Quiet, Nibs. They had three descendants.
What is descendants?
Well, you are one twin.
Did you hear that, John? I am a descendant.
Descendants are only children.
Oh, dear. Now, one night, Mr. Darling became angry, so all the children flew away.
It's an awfully good story.
They flew away to Neverland, where the lost children are.
Wendy, was one of the lost children called Doodles?
Yes, he was.
Ah, I'm in a story! I'm in a story!
Hush. Now, I want you to consider the feelings of the unhappy parents with all their children flown away.
Oh.
Think of the empty beds.
Oh.
It's awfully sad. I don't see how it can have a happy ending. Do you, Nibs?
I'm frightfully anxious.
If you knew how great is a mother's love, you'd have no fear.
I do like a mother's love. Do you like a mother's love, Curly?
I do.
See, our heroine knew their mother would always leave a window open for them to fly back by. So they stayed away for years and had a lovely time.
Did they ever go back?
Let's take a peep into the future. Years have gone by. Who is this elegant lady of uncertain age alighting at the train station?
Oh, Wendy, who is she?
Can it be? Yes. No. It is the fair Wendy. And who are the two noble, portly figures accompanying her, now grown to man's estate? Can they be John and Michael? They are. See, dear brothers, says Wendy, pointing upwards. There is the window still standing open. Ah, now we are rewarded for a sublime faith in a mother's love. So off they flew to Mummy and Daddy, and pen cannot describe the happy scene to follow. What is it, Peter?
Where is it?
It's not
up like you. That my mother would always leave the window open for me. So I stayed away for moons and moons and moons. And then flew back. But the window was barred. For mother had forgotten all about me. And there was another little boy sleeping in my bed.
Are you sure all mothers are like that?
Yes.
Wendy, let us go home. Yes.
No, 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 no.
At once. Perhaps Mummy is in half mourning by now. Peter, will you make the necessary arrangements?
If you wish it.
We cannot bear to lose Wendy.
It'll be worse than before she came.
We shan't let her go. Let's keep her prisoner.
I, Shayera.
Toodles, I appeal to you.
I'm just Toodles. Nobody likes me. But the first who does not behave to Wendy like a gentleman, I will blot him severely.
Wendy, I have asked the Indians to guide you through the wood, as flying tires you so.
Thank you, Peter.
Goodbye, Wendy.
Oh, dear one. If you all come with me, I'm almost certain I can persuade Mother and Father to adopt you.
But won't they think us rather a handful?
Oh, no. It'll only mean a few beds in the drawing room. They can be hidden behind screens if the occasion calls. Peter, can we go?
All right.
And now, Peter, I'm going to give you your medicine before you go. Get your things, Peter.
No. I'm not going with you, Wendy.
Yes, Peter.
No.
To find your mother.
No, no. Perhaps she would say I was old.
I want always to be a little boy and have fun.
But Peter.
No.
Then others must be told. Children! Peter isn't coming.
Find your mothers, I hope you will let them.
You'll remember to change your flannels, Peter?
Yes.
You'll take your medicine?
Yes. Melvin. No fuss, no blubbering. Goodbye, Wendy.
Suddenly, up above, the pirates make their dreadful attack upon the Indians. Below, there is dead silence. Mouths open and remain open. Wendy falls on her knees toward Peter, and all eyes are on him. They are beseeching him mutely not to desert them. Peter seizes his sword, and the lust of battle is in his eye. The tumult ends, and there is a terrible silence.
If the Redskins have won, they will beat the Tom-Tom. It is always their sign of victory.
You will never hear the tom-tom again.
The tom-tom! An Indian victory!
One by one, they exit the underground home into the clutches of the waiting pirates. Peter began to play gaily on his pipes.
moment, Hook emerges into the dark chamber. He produces a vial of poison and adds 5 drops to Peter's medicine cup. Donning his hat at its most rakish angle, he winds his cloak around him and steals away.
Who is it? Tinkerbell, what is it? The Lost Boys have been captured, dragged to the pirate ship along with Wendy. A rescue bird. But first, I'll drink my medicine, just to please her. Well, why not? Poisoned? Who could have poisoned it? Don't be silly. How could Hook have got down here? Besides, I never fell asleep. Tink, how dare you drink my medicine? Well, what's the matter with you?
Tink. Tink, did you drink it to save me? But why, Tink? Tink, how can I save you?
In that moment, Peter realized just how alone he was. There were no children there, and it was nighttime, and they had all left him. But he addressed all who might be dreaming of the Neverland, and were, therefore, nearer than you might think, boys and girls in their 90s.
Do you believe? Do you believe?
Tink knew the time had come to accept her fate, whatever that might be. Some believed, some didn't. A few beasts of the Neverland hissed. Peter and Tinkerbell's eyes met as Peter swore a solemn vow.
It is Hook or me this time.
Alone.
How still the night is. Nothing sounds alive. Now is the hour when children, in their homes, are abed, their lips bright brown with the goodnight chocolate, as their tongues search drowsily for belated crumbs housed insecurely upon their shining cheeks.
Compare with them, the captive children now aboard this boat.
Split infinitives, but 'tis me hour of triumph! Peter, killed at last, and all the boys set to walk the plank. At last, I've reached me peak. All mortals envy me. No little children love me. I'm told they play at Peter Pan. And the strongest! Strongest always chooses to be Peter. They force the baby to be Hook.
There came to him a notion of his untimely death. It was as if Peter's terrible oath had boarded the ship. Hook felt a gloomy desire to make his dying speech, lest presently there should be no more time for it.
Now then, bullies, six of you walk the plank tonight, but I have room for two cabin boys. Which of you is it to be?
You see, sir, I don't think my mother would like me to be a pirate. Would your mother like you to be a pirate, Smiley?
I don't think so. Would your mother like you to be a pirate, Twin?
I don't think so.
Stow this gab!
You, boy, you look as if you had a bit of pluck in you. Didst never want to be a pirate, me hearty.
I once thought of calling myself Red-Handed Jack.
A good name, too. We'll call you that here, bully, if you join.
What do you think, Michael?
What would you call me if I tried?
Blackbeard Joe, I think.
Harsh.
What do you think, John?
I refuse.
And I refuse.
That seals your doom. Bring up their mother and get the plank ready.
Oh, yeah.
Me beauty, you are to see your children walk the plank.
Are they to die?
They are. Silence all, for a mother's final words to her children.
These are my last words, dear boys. I feel as if I have a message from your real mothers, and it is this. We hope our sons will die like gentlemen.
I am going to do what my mother hopes. What are you to do, Nibs?
What my mother hopes. What are you to do, Twin?
What my mother hopes. John?
Then here's for Johnny Plank!
Yo-ho, yo-ho, the frisky plank, you walks along it so, till it goes down and you goes down to Davy Jones below.
Throw the girl overboard.
No!
doomed.
No, lads. No. It's the girl. Never was luck on a pirate ship with a woman aboard. We'll right the ship now that she's gone.
There's none that can save me now.
There's one.
And who's that?
Peter Pan, the Inniger!
Peter Pan! What are you doing, you naughty? That's you! I don't believe you! Speed, where are you going?
Stand aside, boys. This man is mine.
So, Peter Pan, this is all your doing?
Aye, James Hook. This is all my doing.
So, it comes to this. But fly! 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 You would not dare face me, man to man. No. You would fly away like a cowardly sparrow.
No one calls Peter Pan a coward and lives.
Proud and insolent, you! Prepare to meet thy doom.
Dark and sinister man, have at thee.
Practicing, boy?
And what art thou?
I'm youth! I'm joy! I'm freedom.
What? No! No, stay away!
Dreams that night and cried in his sleep for a long time. And Wendy held him tightly. By three bells that morning, they knew that they must now return to that desolate home from which three of our characters took heartless flight so long ago. As we approach the nursery, consider Mrs. Darling in the chair. She has fallen asleep. Supposed to make her happy, we
2 miles at the window now and flying strong. All we need whisper is that they are on the way. Peter was convinced that when they returned to the Darling home, the window would be barred, like it was for him so long ago. Then Wendy would have no choice but to return with him to the Netherlands. Peter knew the lady inside was fond of Wendy, but he was fond of her too, and they certainly could not both have her. But Wendy, John, and Michael found the window open for them after all, which of course was more than they deserved. They alighted on the floor, quite unashamed of themselves, and the youngest one had already forgotten his home.
You have, silly. There's your old bed.
Sure it is.
I say the kennel.
Perhaps Nana is inside it.
Hello, there's a man inside it.
Oh. It's Father.
Oh, let me see Father. He is not so big as the parrot I killed.
Surely he used to not sleep in the kennel.
John. Perhaps we don't remember the old life as well as we thought we did. It's Mother!
So it is!
Then, you are not really our mother, Wendy.
Oh dear, it was quite time that we came back.
Let us sneak over and put our hands over our eyes.
Yeah! No! Let us all slip into our beds and be there when she wakes, just as if we had never been away.
Must be dreaming still.
Mother!
That's Wendy.
Mother!
That's John.
Mother!
That's Michael.
George!
Oh, a little less noise, please.
Oh, my darling!
We counted at 500 and then came up.
We used the stairs because we thought this would make a better impression.
Wendy's mother, will you have us?
Do you think we'll be too much of a handful, sir?
Because if so, we could go away.
We can lie doubled up! I always cut their hair myself.
George.
Oh, no. Oh.
In truth, I am as glad to have them as you are. I had thought that they might have asked my consent as well as yours instead of treating me as a non-entity in my own house.
I don't think he's a non-entity. Do you think he's a non-entity, really?
No, I don't. Do you think he's a non-entity, Slightly?
Rather not.
That's enough. We shall surely find space for all of you in the, in the drawing room.
We'll fit in, sir.
Well then, follow the leader. Mind you, I'm not sure we have a drawing room, but we pretend we do, and so it's all the same. Aha!
Hello, Wendy.
Bye.
Oh dear, are you going away?
Yes.
You don't feel, Peter, that you like to speak with my parents about a very sweet subject?
No.
About me? Peter?
No. I have adopted all the other boys, Peter, and would like so to adopt you as well.
Would you send me to school?
Yes.
And then to an office?
I suppose so.
Soon I would be a man?
Very soon.
I don't want to go to school and learn solemn things. I don't want to be a man. Oh, Wendy's mother supposed I were to wake up one morning and feel there was a beard.
Oh, Peter, I should love
you. Kimberly! No one's gonna catch me and make me a man.
He does so need a mother.
So do you, my love.
But where are you to live?
With Tink. In the house we built for Wendy. The fairies are to plant high up among the treetops where they sleep at nights.
How lovely.
I thought all the fairies were dead.
There are always a lot of young ones. You see, every time a new baby laughs the first time, a new fairy is born. And since there are always new babies, there are always new fairies.
I shall have such fun.
You'll be rather lonely in the evening, sitting by the fire.
I shall have tea. Otherwise, it doesn't matter.
Oh, Peter, you know it matters.
Well, then, come with me to the little house.
May I, Mommy?
Certainly not. I have got you home again, and I mean to keep you.
All right.
I will make you this offer, Peter, to let Wendy go to you for a week, every year, to do spring cleaning.
I accept.
You won't forget me, Peter, will you? Before spring cleaning time comes?
Of course not, Wendy.
Of course, all the boys went to school, and they did very well, some at the top of their class. It is sad to have to say that the power to fly gradually left them. Lack of practice, they called it, but what it meant was they no longer believed. Michael believed longer than the others, although they jeered at him. So he was with Wendy when Peter came for her at the end of the first year. She flew away in the frock she had worn during her time in the Neverland, although her one fear was that Peter might notice how short it had become. But he never noticed. He had so much to say about himself. She had looked forward to thrilling talks with him about old times, but new adventures had already crowded the old ones from his mind.
Who is Captain Hook?
Don't you remember how you killed him and saved all of our lives?
I forget them after I kill them.
I do miss the fairies. Do you think Tink will be glad to see me?
Who is Tink? There are such a lot of fairies. I expect she is no more.
I expect he was right. For fairies don't live long, but they are so little that a short time seems a good while to them. Wendy was pained, too, to realize that the past year was but as yesterday to Peter. It had seemed such a long year of waiting to her. But he was exactly as fascinating as ever, and they had a lovely spring cleaning in the little house in the treetops. The next year, he did not come for her. She waited in a new frock because the old one simply would not fit. But he never came. In fact, that was the last time the girl Wendy ever saw Peter. When they met again, Wendy was a married woman, and Peter was no more to her than a little dust in the box in which she kept her toys. Until finally, many years later, Jane was now asleep in her bed, with Wendy sitting near her side. The window blew open as of old, and Peter dropped in on the floor.
Hello, Wendy.
Hello, Peter.
Hello, where is John?
John's not here now.
Is Michael asleep?
That's not Michael.
Hello, a new one?
Yes.
Boy or girl?
Girl.
Yes.
Peter, are you expecting me to fly away with you?
Of course. That is why I've come. Have you forgotten it is spring cleaning?
I can't come. I've forgotten how to fly.
Well, then I'll teach you again.
Peter, don't waste the fairy dust on me.
What is it?
I will turn on the light so you can see for yourself.
Don't turn on the light!
What is it?
I am old, Peter. I am ever so much more than 20. I grew up long ago.
You promised not to!
I couldn't help it. I'm a married woman now, Peter.
No, you're not!
Yes. And the little girl in my bed is my baby, Jane.
No, she's not!
He does so need a mother.
I know. No one knows it so well as I.
Well, goodbye.
No, no.
It is just a spring cleaning.
He wants me always to do his spring cleaning.
If only I could go with you.
But you see, you can't fly. Peter's mother in turn. And thus it will go on, so long as children are carefree and innocent and heartless.